Hey guys, Kane Green here with Maestro Films, and today is a very exciting day for me because I finally get to launch the series that I had the idea for when I very first started in videography, and that is Video Gear Guide. And what separates this show from a lot of the other gear reviews is that I want to be able to address the issues that young videographers go through. One of the biggest hurdles that I faced in my videography career was trying to figure out what gear I needed, what gear I wanted, and which gear I really didn't need. Because when you first start out, you see all of these videos of these guys who sound like they know what they're talking about, and they convince you to buy this gear that you probably don't even need. Well, personally, I've wasted a lot of money on gear that wasn't necessary for the type of filmmaking that I do. So I wanted to help you out, make sure you don't make those mistakes, and give you as objective of a review as I possibly can give you. With that being said, this first review is devoted exclusively to the first camera that I ever bought, the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera. The primary selling points for this camera are its 13 stops of dynamic range and 12-bit raw recording at a price point that makes it available to beginners. To say that Blackmagic Design has done a pretty good job with its color science is a vast understatement, because in this camera is an image quality that rivals its big brother, the Ursa Mini Pro, and even with the right lighting, the Arri Alexa. That's saying something. So you're a beginner, what is this 13 steps of dynamic range and 12-bit raw, what does that mean to you? Well, dynamic range is your camera's ability to distinguish between light colors and interpret them in the video as various shades as opposed to a blurry mess of the same color. If you're looking for film quality footage and are willing to put up with a few headaches, this is probably the camera you want to look at. So because I am a fan of Blackmagic Design, I wanted to start with the pains that this camera brings with it. And the first pain I want to discuss is the battery life. At most, you're going to get about 45 minutes out of one of these batteries, and most of the time, you're probably going to get about 30. Which means you will have to end up finding a solution, since 45-minute shoots don't really accomplish very much. To be fair, this is one of the batteries. They're very tiny because they have to be to make the camera so small. The solution that I have found is just to go ahead and buy a juice box external battery and hook that up on the rig that I'm using it with. Second pain is that the 3-inch LCD screen on the back is pretty much useless unless you're in perfect conditions. Once you step into a well-lit or sunny area, it becomes nearly impossible to see and absolutely impossible to use for focusing, although the camera does offer zebras and focus assist. The solution that I have found is to buy an external monitor that fit my price range as well as a magnification viewfinder, because those really help in sunny areas. An example of what a video viewfinder would look like on the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera can be seen here in what I call my hammerhead setup, and this is the setup that I usually use with my Pocket Cinema Camera. Because when I'm using it, I'm usually on the go, and I don't have time to continue adjusting my rig. Not to mention that it's fun to pretend like I'm shooting with an old Super 8. The third pain is that the onboard audio recorder is extremely bad. It does not support XLR, which means you won't be pushing any phantom power to your mics from your camera. So the solution that I had to find was with an external recorder, which are not hard to find. You can find a Tascam, a Zoom, or a Sony. I actually use Tascam primarily, and it works like a charm. Because there are so many pieces to this review, and I don't know that I'll cover them all, I wanted to also include a neutral features section, because there are features of the camera that offset the bad with the good. The first is that the Pocket Cinema Camera has a Micro Four Thirds mount with a Super 16mm sensor, which is slightly smaller than a typical Micro Four Thirds sensor. This leads the camera to have a crop factor of 2.88 times that of a full frame camera like the 5D. If you're just starting out, that means that the frame that you would usually get with a lens will be effectively cut by more than a half. So the frame of a 30mm lens more closely resembles that of a 70mm. The focal distance of your lenses will remain the same, which means that the sensors are great for extreme close-ups, but not so great for wide shots without further accessories. In terms of a solution for this, I would recommend the Metabone Speed Booster, because it actually limits the crop factor from 2.88 to just 1.75, which is a lot more manageable. The second neutral feature is that the camera has a maximum ISO of just 1600. That's pretty low, and it means that the camera is not meant for low-light shooting, although it can hold its own given the right lenses. The reason I consider this a neutral feature is because I see a lot of beginning videographers completely destroy their image by jacking up the ISO so high just because they didn't come equipped with lighting or fast lenses. Anything under 1600 is generally considered a good image, and occasionally we do have those situations where we have to go higher. But at that point, you're either not going to get the shot or you just have to take a sacrifice on the image quality. The third neutral feature is that this camera also requires a pretty fast SD card to run with the RAW recording or the ProRes HQ. I would recommend cards such as the SanDisk Extreme Plus or the SanDisk Extreme Pro, both of which have a write speed over 95 megabytes per second. Now, on to my favorite part, the positive features. I can't give the people at Blackmagic Design enough credit for developing a camera that sacrificed just the right features so that they could be accommodated for with a little research and the right accessories. The camera allows you to toggle between film and video color profiles to control how much range you have, and also how much work you want to do in post-production to reach your desired image. It also gives you the freedom to choose between RAW, ProRes HQ, ProRes 422, ProRes Proxy, and ProRes LT. It also allows you to input metadata into the video file. This may not seem like the biggest deal at first, but once you've tried to set up your workflow inside of your chosen video editor, you will see how much help it is to have chronologically listed metadata inside of your video files. The fourth and final positive is that the size of this camera allows you to take it almost anywhere. Even with its accessories, it fits easily inside of a messenger bag or similarly sized carry-on, making it perfect for travel videographers. I have even stored mine with a lens attached in my pocket before when I was using one of my pancake lenses. And there simply is not another cinema camera that allows you to do that. All things considered, I wish I could tell you that this camera was a need, but it really is just a want. So if you want a camera that's going to challenge you and it's going to push you and it's going to make you better as a filmmaker, then this is the camera that you want to look at. And that's not to say that the people who don't want to spend the time doing color grading post-production are any less valuable. Those people just have a different idea of how they want their workflow to go. For me, it's important to have as much latitude as possible because you never are quite sure what's going to come about in post-production. And if you have decided to make a future of filmmaking, then you're going to have to cross these hurdles sooner or later. This camera allows you to knock those out up front because, from experience, there is not much worse than feeling like a beginner when you're working with a bunch of professionals. Because of this camera's size and mobility, I usually use it as a B-roll camera because I'm able to put it on my Zion crane and slap a pancake lens on it and get filmic quality moving shots. I will say that at this point in my career, because I started with the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera, I have not found another camera that challenged me anywhere near that much. When I was putting this review together, I thought of a quote by Jack White from the film It Might Get Loud, and I wanted to share it with you guys.
What can I do with three strings on a guitar instead of six? It takes me three steps to get over to play the organ in the middle of this song. Put it four steps away. Then I'll have to run faster and I'll push myself harder to get to it.
Hopefully you guys caught the connection, because this camera is like filming with a three-string guitar sometimes. It is putting itself an inch further than what you would usually get to, but it forces you to stay sharp, forces you to push yourself and keep your mind on what you're doing, and that results in a better film on the back end. Now, I do want to mention that the Pocket Cinema Camera 4K will be coming out in September, but I don't believe that it will make this camera any less valuable to beginners. The reason that I'm going to be purchasing the new camera is because it solves the ISO issue, as well as it gives me the opportunity to shoot at a frame rate higher than 30 frames per second, which I didn't put even in here because I have cameras that solve that problem and it doesn't even become an issue for me, but it would be nice to have on my B-roll camera the ability to shoot higher than 30 frames per second. That does not mean that I will be getting rid of my original Pocket Cinema camera, because the new one looks like it's going to be heavier and it's not anywhere near as small. So that's it for this review. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comments below. I'll be happy to answer them whenever I can. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I hope you all have a great week.